would like to now present Carol Berry, a board member, author, and freelance writer, who will introduce our speakers. And I just wanted to say that this talk, because it's so important to us and to for posterity, is being taped, and we will have that in our archives to look back on. Carol.
We will talk today about the Twomblys family of Florham, the Florham estate itself, and of the new life of Fairleigh Dickinson when it became in 1958 here. And many of you are aware of the Twombly family, but our resident experts, Arthur Vanderbilt and Walter Savage, are going to fill in the outlines for us of what is essentially a 50-year history of the family at Florham, more than 50 years of that, and of a way of life that will probably never be replicated. And let me just introduce them. Walter has a singular distinction of having taught the first class here at Fairleigh Dickinson in 1958. He's Professor Emeritus of English here, and but he never retired, really. He has segued into being one of the busiest volunteers around. He was Chairman of the Humanities Council, on the board of the Shakespeare Festival, Vice President of McCullough Hall, President of the Washington Association. Should I go on? And of course, the Friends of Florham. Arthur Vanderbilt, we are so pleased to have him here, is a historian, author, writer, and avid gardener. He has written several books. He's also a lawyer, I should say. He has written several books, among them Fortune's Children, The Fall of the House of Vanderbilt, which he will be signing later on afterward there, which was nominated for a Pulitzer Prize in history. And he is on several boards, Greenwood Gardens. He's an honorary trustee of the Friends of Florham. He's on the Summit Public Library Board. And I should say we will have a Q&A after the talk. And in the meantime, Arthur will begin it, so just enjoy.
Carol, thank you so much, Wolf, and I appreciate that introduction. And we are delighted to be here. We share a love of this special place. We hope to be able to communicate some of that love on to you this afternoon. Where we are today is a great university which has done some amazing things over the past 50 years, and that's a story in and of itself. But if you half close your eyes, you can see that this was once an incredible estate. The building we're in today was not holding administrative offices or classrooms upstairs or faculty offices upstairs. This was a home, and it was a home for a family. There was a wife, Florence, her portrait is right above me, and her husband, Hamilton, whose portrait is over that fireplace down there, and four children, Alice, Ruth, Florence, and Hamilton Jr., and of course, a staff of 126 to take good care of them. Where we're sitting today was not a lecture hall, it was not a meeting room. This was Florence's drawing room, and I think we have a photograph of it. Maybe we can pop on the screen. There it is. This is the drawing room as it was when the Twombleys were here, and you'll see the magnificent tapestries which hung on these walls, which are now in a museum. Three great crystal chandeliers went down this room, the Three Sisters, they were called. And just to give you a little bit of perspective, each chandelier was 8.5 feet tall and 6.5 feet wide. Each of them had 50 lights and, of course, many hundreds of prisms. You'll see that mouth-watering furniture. Wouldn't it be nice to take a piece home with you this afternoon? The oriental rugs on the floor, and of course, on a day like this, there would be a fire in both of these fireplaces. And if you half close your eyes, you'll almost see Florence right there looking out those doors at her Italian gardens. What was she thinking? This is what we want to communicate to you today. What was it like to live here if you folks had lived here? What would it be like to be a guest here at Florham? What would it be like to be a member of the staff here? I've often thought if this couldn't be my own house, I think I would have loved to have worked here. It seemed to have been a great place. And that's what Walter and I will be talking about. To get you here, which is the place we love, I have to give you just a few minutes of historical background. What gave rise to all this? Well, clearly it was a result of a great American fortune. And that was the fortune accumulated by Cornelius Vanderbilt, He was born in 1794 in Staten Island in a small farmhouse which overlooked the waters of the New York Harbor. His father was a farmer and made just enough money to support the 9 children that were in the family, raising the produce himself and selling some of it in New York City. Well, Cornelius was fascinated by the waterfront, and he would get down to it as often as he could when he wasn't helping his father on the farm. He grew into a very strong teenager. He was over 6 feet tall, very powerfully built, and a lot of energy. And when he was 16 or 17, he got an old scow, and he started taking passengers back and forth from Staten Island to the Battery in New York City for fares. And his customers learned they could really rely on this teenager. He would go out in any sorts of weather when the other ferrymen would not go out on the harbor, and he got his customers back and forth on time. So he built up that sort of reputation. He was having the time of his life and would strut around the waterfront as if he were the captain of a clipper ship. And of course, he had heard the sailors all of his life, and he swore like an old salt himself. So the men on the waterfront thought this was very humorous. Here's this teenager with the old scow, and they called him with the nickname the Commodore as a joke. And he loved that name, and that nickname stuck with him throughout his life. Until his death at the age of 82, he was always Commodore Vanderbilt. Well, he built up his little ferry line, and then was wise enough to realize that the steamships he began to see on the Hudson River might be the wave of the future. And in 1818, at the age of 24, he bought his first steamship, sold his little ferry line, which he built up, and bought a steamship, and learned how to operate that. He got a line which ran from Elizabeth in New Jersey over to the Battery. He would make his fortune in steamships and later in railroads, which I'll tell you a little bit about, but he always followed the same method of operation. He would get a line, see what the competition was doing, then undercut the competition ruthlessly. He would even cut his fares down to zero, and no fares whatsoever to get his passengers and to drive out the competitors. He then would raise his rates back up above where they were when he first came into the scene and cut down the quality of the service. I mean, who needed lifeboats or life cushions on a steamship? You know, it's nonsense. So it turned into a very profitable operation. By the time 1840s was in mid-40s, he was controlling 100 steamships, and he was employing more men than any other business in the United States, and it accumulated several million dollars, which was a large fortune in those days. Let me backtrack just a little to tell you about his personal life. When he was 19, he married his neighbor and first cousin, Sophia. Together, they had 13 children. He treated poor Sophia almost as one of the workmen in his business. For instance, he bought a small inn for his passengers on one of the steamship lines. And Sophia had to do all the cooking, all the cleaning, in addition to raising the 13 children. When they began to get a little bit more money, they did hire a governess. She was in her early 20s. She was very attractive. And of course, the commodore fell in love with her and began an affair with her. Well, what do you do when your governess is in the house and your wife is in the house? It's very simple. You have your wife committed to an insane asylum. And fortunately, the directors realized, or that institution realized, that Sophia was not insane and would quickly release her. But he did that several times to get her out of the house. They had 8 daughters. And in the Commodore's eyes, the trouble with the daughters, they would marry and, of course, lose the name Vanderbilt. They wouldn't carry on that name, that's unthinkable to him. So he didn't have much regard for them. I'll just tell you one very quick little anecdote. One of his daughters sold her home and brought the proceeds to her father to invest for her. He said he'd be glad to do it. He invested the money. He was a very good speculator. He quickly doubled the money and then would return none of it to her, saying that women are not fit to have money anyway. That's the kind of father he was. He had 3 sons who survived childbirth. One was George, his favorite, who died in the Civil War. His namesake Cornelius developed epilepsy when he was a teenager. Of course, the Commodore thought this was a form of mental illness and had the poor guy committed the same insane asylum. They quickly released Cornelius Jr. because he was obviously not insane, but the Commodore wanted very little to do with him. And the other son was William Henry Vanderbilt. He was a large man, kind of clumsy looking. He had a large head. He looked kind of slow, and the Commodore treated him that way. We call him every name in the book. He called him Blatherskite and Chowderhead and Chucklehead. And poor Billy took it very meekly and would wanted more than anything to do whatever would please his father. That's the kind of guy he was. So he developed in sort of the ultimate yes man. And when you have the personality of someone like the Commodore, it's very handy to have yes men around you. So the Commodore had to develop a respect for William, for Billy. He bought him a farm on Staten Island, which William quickly made very prosperous, which again pleased the Commodore. And later the Commodore would get him involved in his railroad business. Well, that is the family life in brief. The Commodore is going along with the steamship business. He's now 68 years old, has accumulated $40 million with that business, running his monopoly. He was a monopolist, pure and simple, and was having the time of his life. Most men would retire at that age of 68. A lot of men were no longer living at 68, 1862. The Commodore got a new interest. He saw small railroad lines coming into New York City and started buying them up. And his friends shook their heads. They said, this old coot is crazy. He's going to lose all the money he's worked so hard to accumulate. He doesn't know what he's doing. But the Commodore did. He bought up all these little railroad lines, consolidated them together into a network which ran around the northeast part of the country, and built the New York Central Railroad system. The northeast out to Chicago was the most prosperous part of our country in those days. And this became a cash cow in the late 1860s, the 1870s, and the 1880s. The money was pouring in. He was having the time of his life. By the way, he didn't spend any money. He would never build something like this. This was totally out of his vision. He was hoarding the money. He admitted he had been insane on the subject of money making all of his life. Well, you can picture what his children are thinking. They're now in their 40s and 50s. They're thinking, when is the old man going to die? When can we get our hands on this pile of money? Because he certainly was not giving any to them. Well, he was hale and hearty into his 80s, but finally at the age of 82, things started going wrong. He was bedridden for most of the year, and he died on January 4 of 1877. The will was read, and under the will, the poor daughters received about $500,000 each. Cornelius, with the epilepsy, received a trust fund of $200,000, and the rest and remainder went to his son, William Henry Vanderbilt, Billy the Blatherskite. And it was a sum of $105 million. This was more money than was held then in the United States Treasury, and the Commodore was, in fact, the richest man in the world at that time. I saw a study done just a year or two ago which compared all the great American fortunes, the Carnegies and the Fricks and the Rockefellers and the Mellons, up to Bill Gates and Warren Buffett, laying them all out on a level playing field. And it's surprising the Commodore's was the largest of those American fortunes. We know that Bill Gates, at the height of his Microsoft stock days, had over $70 billion. So this is a fortune, in today's terms, would be in that range. He left all of his, we said, to William, his son, who was then 56 years old when the Commodore died. William would only live 8 more years. He became head of the New York Central, built that system up. He died of a massive stroke when he was 64. But in those 8 years, he doubled the amount of money the Commodore had left him. He then left a fortune of $200 million, which is almost unthinkable what that meant. There was no inheritance tax in those days. There was no estate taxes. There was no income taxes. This was a pure pile of money. And now his children, and Florence is one of his children, he had 4 sons and 4 daughters, received that money when they were in their 20s and 30s. Florence had been born in 1854 in the farmhouse on Staten Island. When she was 10 years old, the Commodore gave his son William a house in New York City to get him closer to New York Central. So she grew up in New York City. And she married on November 21st, 1877, the same year the Commodore passed away. He passed away in January of that year. She married in November of that year. She married Hamilton Twombly, whose portrait is back there. He was a proper Bostonian. He had graduated from Harvard. The year he graduated, his father passed away and left him controlling interest in 2 railroads. Okay. 2 railroads, those were great days. Hamilton was an incredible guy, really had his feet on the ground, a great financial genius. He took that money and made his own fortune before he even married Florence. So it was the combination of 2 great fortunes when they married. They were married at St. Bartholomew's Church. You have to realize in those days, the very wealthy were the celebrities of that day. They are, as we have the movie stars today, those were the celebrities back then. it was as if Brad Pitt and Angelina Jolie, for instance, were getting married today over in New York City. There would be a mob scene. Well, there's a mob surrounding their wedding. Thousands of onlookers are pressing in. The police and security guards could hardly hold them back. This was written up in the New York Times in a very disparaging way. They called Hamilton Harrison, this is front page news, by the way. They discussed the cost of everything Florence was wearing. They made disparaging remarks about the guests. Hamilton and Florence were very private people. They wanted nothing to do with the public life. And I think what we're sitting in today is one of the results of their desire for privacy. So that gives you a little bit of background, gets you up to speed of how this sort of came about.
And then we go to what Walter always refers to as the Vanderbilt family edifice contest. They all sort of vied with each other for building the biggest homes, the best homes, and they had the mansion in New York, they had Vinland in Newport, which is now the home of Salve Regina College, and then they decided that they would build out here. So Walter, tell us how they came here, and why they came here.
Well, the reason they came here is quite obvious. All the rich people wanted to get in this area. There were dozens and dozens of multimillionaires all along the stretch from here into Morristown, the richest mile in the United States at the time. So the Twomblys weren't doing anything pioneering when they came out here. They were following the herd, but the herd, of course, was well dispersed. All of them had many acres. The neighbors, closest neighbors, were the Dodges, who she was worth $101 million and he was worth $60 million, so they were richer than the Twomblys. But that doesn't mean the Twomblys were underfunded by any stretch of the imagination. As Arthur has said, there were no taxes. They made $10,000 a day, even in the worst of times. Even during the Depression, they were still turning $3.5 million a year out of the sulfur investment that Hamilton had made. They came out here, first of all, at the spot that is now Bailey Ellard. It wasn't Bailey Ellard then, of course. It was owned by Danforth. He sold to Twombly. Twombly sold to Bell, who created a place called Bellwood. Bellwood wanted to expand it, but he never completed it. He had a fire. It was bought eventually by a man named DeBarry, who was Mum's Champagne. He was there only a couple of years, and he sold to a man named Leland Ross, who eventually sold the estate to the Diocese of Paterson, and it became the Bailey Ellard Regional Parochial High School. Closed, I think, in 2005, although may have a firmer date than that. It's no longer there. It's now the Center for Madison Municipal Operations while they're repairing the Dodge Memorial down in the center of town. They didn't think about this when they first came out here at all. They wanted to build that place up, and they were dissuaded from doing that by Olmsted, who said, you'll never have a real estate there. It'll be nothing but a villa. And in those days, the villa was a downscale term. So they started buying property, over 1,400 acres along here, and eventually moved over to what is now Florham. I should point out that the foundation of Madison's thriving and quite numerous Italian-American community traces its roots to the laborers who came here for Mrs. Twombly. They had at least 100 of them leveling the ground up here between Fairleigh and St. Elizabeth's. It was marshland, woodland, inaccessible. Even the local hunters wouldn't go in there. And as I pointed out when I made a presentation on this subject some time ago, when I first came to Fairleigh Dickinson, I was walking across the lawn one day with a member of the psychology department, and a snapping turtle, that big, I'm not exaggerating, hissed at us. He was behind the library. He had come down from the marshland up at St. Elizabeth's, a vestige of that old, untamed country that the Italian immigrants began to fill in. It took them a year to do it. Very little money, by the way. Well, I was saying the Twombly's income was $10,000 a day. One of my old friends, now dead, he died 6 or 7 months short of 100 years, Pat Luciano downtown, had a father who started digging with a shovel right out front here, the footing for the foundation for this building. And he got 75 cents a day, 10 cents of which he had to kick back to the contractor who hired him. And it was They used Italian laborers profligately throughout this area. Here's a Madison Eagle is full of accounts of these swarthy little fellows, as they called them, footing the rail lines over to Morristown, down the center of Madison. The community is entirely different now, but it does go back to the Twombly work, especially the fielding and then building on this mansion. The mansion took a long while to build, as a matter of fact. They started in 1893. It wasn't really completed until about 1900, and some of the operations continued after that even. It opened in 1899 officially, when 300 of the most important people in this area came to a welcoming party Mrs. Twombly sponsored. And people walked in and out at will for several months after that, until somebody, unauthorized, took a photograph with a brownie of Mrs. Twombly, and that was the end of the public visitation. Nobody got on the lawns or anywhere else after. It reminds me that Mrs. Twombly was a person who regarded herself as a true Vanderbilt. Now, if you look at our guest today, this latter-day Vanderbilt, you have a mistaken impression of what the early Vanderbilts were like. He's an entirely proper gentleman. But the Commodore was a thug in some respects. He really was. He smashed policemen off horses, threw them off his boat, and until Alva came along, William Kissam's wife, the Vanderbilts were lower infidig people in New York City. Alva threw such a big party that Mrs. Astor had to accept invitation, and that finally broke the barrier against the Vanderbilts. But there were nouveau riche of the most unseemly type to some of the old Dutch aristocrats in New York City. Mrs. Twombly wanted none of that, as Arthur has intimated. She regarded the rest of the Vanderbilts as publicity, as John Mason Brown points out in the Proper Bostonians. Especially people like Alva, who was always in the newspapers. She was a very active woman, as a matter of fact, one of the great early feminists, but not entirely a reasonable individual. She's the one that forced Gloria into the marriage with that dreadful man, the seventh Duke of Blenheim, who probably infected her with syphilis, as a matter of fact. She was forced into that marriage, more or less. Mrs. Twombly wanted to keep away from all that. She's kept away from the telephone, which she regarded as a dreadful instrument. You worked here a year before you got invited to her chamber up to the back room on the second floor. The service did not get a lot of money, by the way. You could hire an Irish girl in England in the Victorian period for $25 a year. I think they got something like $5 a week, maybe. And when one of them left here and went to another wealthy family, they mentioned their salary, and the new employer said, "But I know you got much less than that from Mrs. Twombly." And she said, "Yes, but that was from Mrs. Twombly, madam." building itself cost $200,000. Surprising, huh? That didn't include what the interior represented, all the tapestries. All these walls, even when I first came here in 1958, were covered with silk, all these rooms. They had to move them because students would take ballpoint pens and pick at the holes, you know. But everything in the mansion was covered with fabric, all the walls, upstairs and downstairs. But this was when I first taught in this room. I had 187 students in here, by the way, in September of 1950. These were all fabric-covered walls. The mansion, the now Hennessy Hall, was a combination of very careful penny-pinching and luxury. Certain things that Mr. Twombly wouldn't go for irritated the hell out of old Olmsted, who finally just decided to keep away from the place. He didn't want to work with him. He had his adopted son and stepson and another man, Warren Hastings, do most of the work that he was supposed to do on the manscaping. But Mr. Twombly was a typical Victorian entrepreneur. He and Dr. Ward Florham Park decided they could save a few hundred bucks a year by incorporating the community over there, which was variously called Columbia, Broomtown, many other things. Why shouldn't they incorporate it? Because they would save the tax money on it. And why not incorporate it when everybody in the community worked for either Twombly or Ward anyway? So it was what the American equivalent of one of those old English rotten boroughs. And that's the way this place got its start.
Walter, so, you want to mention, put up some of the, that's the state, you mentioned some of the other buildings that we've...
On the campus?
Yeah.
Are they up there? Oh, yeah. Well, this was their stable. It's now our science building. It had tile walls. Every stall had tile walls. They worked about 6 months after I got here, finishing off the stable as a science building. Mrs. Twombly kept her horses in there, and they had fantastic horses, by the way. They had a good, big dairy business in this area, and they made a lot of money on their dairy. They also had a complex of cars. These, by the way, are pictures, as Arthur knows, by Shirley Burton.
A grandson of Florence. Yeah.
And this is the orangery. Right over here now, the front of the library. And that is another shot of it. You can see that it had glass panels in the roof at one time. They were to let the sunlight in because the citrus fruits were in that building for many years. Shirley Burton talks about the deliciousness of the fruit that he got from those places. We took the glass out, not because we were hostile to the idea of sunlight coming in, but because they had a rock concert here, and the students in their exuberance decided they wanted to sit on the roof with a big crowd and listen to the music, and it looked like a perilous operation, so they decided they had to get rid of the glass, as they did also in what was Ruth's Playhouse in the 1920s. And this is the Great Hall entrance right here, with, I think, the busts of the 12 emperors of Rome.
Yeah,
there's one right here. And I can't see a lot. Well, the tapestries were sold at the auction here, which we'll talk about later. And you got a very small price, about a third, I think, of what the Twombly's had paid for them. In fact, I was talking to Arthur and Carol just before we got in here today, and I was appalled to find out that the whole possession of this place, except what the Burdens moved away with, ran for $140,000.
We'll talk about the auction.
And the interior appointments were probably at least $1.8 million when they bought them originally. What is this? Do you know?
I don't know.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
Yes. Overlooking the terrace.
All Twombly's rooms ran about 100 in this building, by the way, and 125 staff members, who a former grocer in Madison told me the Twombly's fed, well, Mrs. Twombly fed, even when she wasn't here. The staff stayed here, and she bought groceries for them downtown the whole time. Now, Arthur has a figure somewhere about the annual expense. But
yeah, Carol, we've gotten into the archives now. That
yeah, we should tell you, for people who, we got a wonderful gift from Edward Burden, who's the great-grandson of the Burden side of the family, the Vanderbilts, of archives that are ledger books, photographs, everything. In these ledger books, some of them are missing, but a lot of them detail just the cost of running not only this, but the New York House and the Newport House. The scale of living was unbelievable, but you have some of the figures on this.
Yeah, I think, Carol, you found that the cost of running this place was about $250,000 a year, which was a staggering amount of money back in the days when they were operating. In the ledgers, they break it down on a month-by-month basis, but that was the gross figure. Incredible.
Yeah, I mean, the figures included not just this house, the stables, the land over where Esso was the farm.
Farm, right.
And that was a working farm also. that they sold things, but nonetheless, there was a lot of expense involved in that, and they were greenhouses and all. I don't know if Walter mentioned, they had about 1,100 acres here.
More.
Here and across, you know, which is unheard of today. Maybe that's the organ there.
It's right out here.
Yeah, this
right out here.
This was actually purchased in 1918, which is after, we should mention that there's some tragedies in this family. One of the daughters, Alice, that's her portrait right down there. She died when she was 16 of pneumonia. And then the son, the only son, Hamilton Jr., had graduated from Groton, about to go into Harvard. He was a counselor at a summer camp, and he drowned at Summers. And this was devastating, obviously, for the parents. Hamilton himself died a few years later in 1910. And one of the daughters, Florence, which one is Florence over there?
She. This is Ruth, that's Florence.
Yeah, Florence married in 1904, so she was out of the picture. So left here in this estate is Florence, who I think was 56 when her husband died, and Ruth.
Now, Hamilton's death was peculiarly diagnosed as tuberculosis of the larynx. I've never heard of that anywhere except in that death notice, but some people think he died out just plain grief over the death of his son. He had a strong dynastic sense.
Yes.
You notice he didn't stop at three daughters. He wanted a son.
And he really had built this place for his son, for Hamilton Jr., who you saw up there.
Right.
And there's Florence much later in life.
And that picture, as Arthur and I were agreeing before the meeting, is not done, that portrait was not done here, because the date will tell you it's painted before this building was completed.
Maybe you want to talk a little, both of you, about the life that was lived here, the family.
Yes, well this...
That photo there gives you some idea of what kind of lady Mrs. Twombly was. She was a lady of extremely firm resolution, no question about it. She had set some rules which seemed almost tyrannical to us. The former wife of one of the vicars, rectors down at the Grace Church, had lunch with Mrs. Twombly here one day. And she pointed out that everybody had to keep his or her eye on how much progress Mrs. Twombly was making doing away with her meal, because when she finished, all the plates were taken. I've also read, it may be apocryphal, I kind of hope it is, but in another way, I hope it isn't, that Mrs. Twombly couldn't stand functional things like coughing and sneezing. And if Hamilton had to sneeze, he would get up from the table, just down the hall here, come out into the hall, do his sneezing, and go back in, crestfallen.
That's a true story.
But that's she.
Yeah. Arthur, you want to talk about the entertainment?
Yes, well, I mean, after Hamilton died and the one daughter married and went off and the poor other children died, it's Ruth and her mother left here on this great estate by themselves. But they really did not go into a period of mourning. They were very much involved in entertaining, and they would hold several parties each season. We should mention, they only used this estate, Florham, where we are today, May and June of every year. Then they would go to Newport for the summer. They would come back here Labor Day through Thanksgiving, and after Thanksgiving go to New York City home for the winter season. So this was only used for a little bit of the year. They would come out here on the weekends, even during the winter, I guess just to see it. But in season, they would hold five parties, major parties in the spring and five parties in the fall season. And these were major functions. Each would have 30 to 50 guests at each party. They would come in from New York City on a special train, and there was a siding that came right into this estate. As you come in through the gatehouse area, right on the left, apparently there's a place where they get trains coming right in, their little special car. The guests would disembark there. There would be a tea on Friday afternoon, a high tea here, an enormous dinner Friday night. We'll tell you about the chef in just a minute. We'll tell you some of the workers here. The next day, they would either play golf at the Morris County Country Club, which Florence helped to found, or they would go to the playhouse to swim or play tennis or walk around the grounds or maybe drive in the country. An enormous dinner Saturday evening, always starting at 8 o'clock, many, many different courses, which we can tell you about. And then a light dinner at midnight, which was lobster and champagne, and then to bed. 37 bedrooms upstairs, so that all the guests were housed up there, with room for their maids and servants who came with them. Sunday was really a repeat, but actually a bigger dinner, believe it or not. How they ate all this, I don't know. And that is when Florence would hire a man who played the organ to come in from New York City and to play the organ out in the hall for a special recital. And she always sat to the left of the organ, and when he went through the concert, she would nod at a certain point, he would play her favorite song, she would then rise from sort of a throne chair she was in and ascend the stairs to her bedroom, and that was the end of the evening. There's one great anecdote. This was a...
She had a magic fan. When she closed the fan, that meant things are done.
Yes, yeah. And she dictated. A party there that came into the Labor Day weekend, and there was a guest who came down on Monday morning, Labor Day, and he saw that all his suitcases were piled by the front door. And he said to the butler, you know, Mrs. Twomblys doesn't expect us to leave today, does she? This is Labor Day, a legal holiday. All our offices are closed. The butler bowed slightly and left to convey this news to Mrs. Twombly. Begging your pardon, sir, he announced upon his return, Mrs. Twombly says to tell you she has never heard of Labor Day. And that was the end of that weekend. There's also another great story. As Walter has mentioned, this place was run very formally. There was a butler who greeted you at the front door, and there were footmen dressed in full livery. The maroon color of the Vanderbilt family with silver, sterling silver buttons and breeches and special black shoes.
She also had a chef, yeah. Chef Donat, the French chef, who was probably like a king in his own right.
Oh my gosh, yeah.
He was theoretically paid at least $25,000 way back when a year, had his own yacht and everything, and he sort of determined what everyone ate.
Yes. He was here for 38 years. The menu would always be handwritten in French. And the great thing, he would tell the head gardener what he wanted the menu to be early in the morning. The gardeners would come back in 2 hours with all the vegetables, which are all grown here, all the fruits from the orangerie, the produce, the fresh milk, the butter, everything came in to Chef Donan's kitchen within 2 hours. What fascinated me is when the Twombly's went to Newport for the summer or New York City for the winter, the food still was produced here and shipped to them. Chef Donan would call from Newport and say, tomorrow we want the following items. They'd be put on the railroad car over in the field here, brought to Hoboken in the evening, and then brought by train up to Newport. So there they were when the chef was there, woke in the morning. Same with New York City. A nice way to live. But I just want to mention, here is poor Florence. She's now an elderly woman, as we see in one of these shots. And she only has two grandsons, and they're coming to visit her here. Now, if you were the grandmother, you'd be excited to have a visit by your grandchildren, wouldn't you? You'd probably be, when are they going to be here? You're looking out the windows. But here is one of her grandsons describing a visit about the age of 10. And this was William Burden, whose portrait is down there, okay? He says, what impressed me most when I first went to Florham was a pair of marble lions on either side of the front door and the front door itself. It must have been at least 11 feet high and 6 inches thick, made of mahogany, with a shine you could see your face in. The front and back of the door were decorated with panels and the hinges were silver. As you drove up, the door would slowly open, like the lowering of a drawbridge to a medieval castle. Standing in the hall in front of the 7-foot marble fireplace was a very tall, distinguished-looking gentleman in a morning coat and striped trousers. This was Frederick, the Swedish butler. He wore pince-nez glasses, and his welcoming smile was chosen with care. You just picture sort of a glacial smile. At his right was a footman standing at attention, dressed in Vanderbilt maroon livery with silver buttons, with a Twombly crest of a lion rampant on them. The air of formality stayed with us when we went in to kiss Grandma. Now notice she was not at the front door to greet them, who was seated in her wing chair in the library with her feet on a footstool. She would greet us in a dry voice. Bill, do you like your school? And surely you're getting to be fat. Then we go upstairs to change into sweaters for the out of doors. So everything with Florence, even with the grandchildren, was a very formal type of life that was lived here. And the amazing thing is that life was lived here through the 1940s, and Ruth was here thereafter in the 1950s.
There is a book by one of the grandchildren, Shirley Burden, and it's all photographs. And he does a picture like of the playhouse, and underneath is just one line. He said, "But you can't play here." And then the stables, "But you can't ride here." You know, and that's the whole book. And that was the scene, what it was like for the grandchildren.
They'd play in the leaves out under the grove of trees right outside.
The playhouse, by the way, was built for one person, Ruth, 1920s. And it had a putting green out front. There was a special walkway that led up through the grove to the playhouse. It had a fantastic indoor pool with the murals on the wall and plantings all around it. It was not a competitive swimming pool, but it was a good recreational area. And that had to be torn down, much to the chagrin of many of us, because it was a Warren and Wetmore building. And while McKim, Mead, and White have probably much better known, Warren and Wetmore were probably better architects. And many people think, including one of the architectural authorities whom we had lecture here, many people think that that building, which is torn down, was the greatest bit of the Florham past. It had to be torn down, they said, because it couldn't be used effectively and efficiently as a classroom building, which it now is. And it was built for Ruth, and as Carol just said, there were signs there saying you can't play here. Ruth paid no attention to that. Ruth was the free spirit of the Twombly family. She was probably gay, and she was unquestionably a heavy drinker. In fact, I've read that she died falling down the steps at the Ritz in Paris. Well, if you're going to have an accident, why not at the Ritz? I wouldn't like to do it at the Nautilus downtown or something, but she died from her injuries. But when she was here, she had lavish parties up there, and although I'm yielding to a temptation, to giving in to something I shouldn't, because if I start telling stories, you'll think that emeritus is a synonym for anecdotage. But that one party, Ruth came as Cleopatra, and she hired four athletes to bear her on a sort of a couch they carried over their head and walked around all through the evening. They all were drinking heavily, and when they got into the swimming pool, all five of them fell into the water. So Ruth did some playful stuff in the playhouse, no question. It was still here when I came. A clay court, glass roof. What kind of expense is that for a university? Maximum four people can use a building that had to be rolled daily and moistened repeatedly. So they had to get rid of the tennis court in the playhouse. Eventually, they got rid of the playhouse. But it was a wonderful building with cherry paneling on one of the walls. A few scraps of it are left up in the new athletic building. But it was an absolutely remarkable room, all cherry paneled. And a very lovely building, it really was. This is a university, not a spa, and there are certain conflicts between running a university and trying to maintain a heritage, and they're not always easily solved. I have to pause here and compliment Emma Joy and the people who were instrumental in the work of the Friends, including the new president, Linda, for doing a significant amount of stuff, which the university would not, well, didn't think about doing, and probably could not have planned to do without the Friends' support.
Florence and Ruth died within a couple of years of each other, right?
Yes, yeah.
And then
Florence in 1952 at the age of 98.
So Ruth inherited everything, and then she died then. And so the house in New York and here, they were auctions. The first one was at Park Bernay in New York in January 1955, and then it was in June here. And I've read figures saying that there are anywhere from 700 to 1,400 people who came to the auction here. I mean, it was just amazing what they had. You can talk a little bit about it.
And it was certainly a mob scene. number of visitors just came to see what this place was all about. I had never been in here. Since that time that someone took a photograph of Florence out on the terrace there that Walter mentioned, the gates were closed. That was back in, I think, 1900. And no members of the public ever were allowed in. Well, here, all of a sudden, it's opened up. So there, I think 10,000 people came in to walk around the mansion and see what this was all about. And then the auction. A lot had been taken out by the Burden family, Florence's family. I think there were 12 movie vans of stuff that came out of here. But then, for instance, the great tapestries were auctioned off. Now, the Twombleys had purchased those for $175,000. I think it's a figure for 37 just monumental tapestries.
Okay, the Barberini tapestries.
Woven in 1640 by King Louis the 13th, I think.
Yeah.
What did they go for at auction, do you know?
The whole group of them, a total of $15,000. So you can see that the change in prices over the years.
Part of the problem with the auction was that the things were of such a scale that a lot of places couldn't take them, you know.
And picture a tapestry covering that wall. It's not going to fit certainly in my home, and maybe not in yours either. Carol found they're now in a museum out in California.
We've been sort of searching tapestries. Marilyn Rye has a friend who's an expert on tapestries, and we think they're in a, some of the Barberini tapestries are in a museum in San Diego at this point. We've been looking all over. It's kind of interesting. I mean, they had Barberinis also in New York, but we're talking about the ones that hung in the hall that were shown in the first picture here. Some of the things, McCullough Hall Museum, the man who founded that, Parsons Todd, the former mayor of Morristown, bought an unbelievable cache of goodies, chandeliers, paintings, Chippendale chairs.
Curtains, yes.
For $10,000. It's, you know, even then it was a steal.
He bought one of the chandeliers from this room, I think, for
$1,500. One of them was called the Skinny Sister, and one of those beautiful glass ones, and that's at McCullough Hall.
And the other one was the study.
Pardon me?
The one in the study
was also. Yeah, yeah. And, but what happened to a lot of the other things we sort of get interested in, but we really don't know in there. I think for me, the tapestries are some of the most interesting story in there.
There's one more comment about the door, which reveals something about Mrs. Twombly as well. The big center door was exclusively reserved for the family when the Twombleys were here. This door up at this end was for the housekeeper. The door, it's now the president's door, right, was the chef's door. And nobody used those doors except those designated people. The rest of us all went in the back end down there, including the former mayor of Madison, Jack Dunn, who worked here as a child. Arthur's quite interested, I know, in the life the staff led here. And Jack, I interviewed for the Friends of Florham newsletter several years ago, and told me that he had two or three jobs. One was painting the large board wooden fence that ran completely around the grounds at one time. They had to keep it painted green. The other one was putting up a display of plants in the playhouse every Saturday. They pyramided various kinds of plants. And they also had a man who raked sand garden, which Mrs. Twombly would inspect and approve or disapprove once a week. And he told me, I forget what he made, very little, but he told me that when Ruth came down the driveway in her car, all the people working on the lawns or whatever they were doing along the roadway were required to turn their back to the driveway so they did not facially confront Ruth's progress. It's an old Victorian custom, started in England. There's a book by a man named Boyd, which I read some years ago. His mother was a servant in a Victorian household, and she was in the hallway in the morning very early. They got up at 4 o'clock, some of them. If the member of the family came down the hallway, they had to turn and face the wall, because if they didn't, they might see the madam of the house with her hair askew or something. But the same principle was applied here. You didn't look the Twombleys directly in the face, according to Jack Dunn. Interesting. would be interviewed by Mrs. Twombly 1 year after they were hired. They were taken up, the maids were taken up to her bedroom a year after they joined the force here. So it was a, you know, it was a Victorian caste society, no question about it.
Before we finish, I'd like to ask both Arthur and Walter, are there any mysteries? Are there any things you'd like to know that you don't know from all your research?
I think there's so much. I think we're just touching the very surface of it today. We know so little about Florence, and we know she did not use the telephone, as Walter said, but there must be correspondence out there. Even just get a few of her letters would give us such an insight into her personality. We have just a few of these anecdotes we've told today that give us a little bit of idea of what she was like. I'm sure somewhere out there is her correspondence. I think also finding some of the furnishings of this place. For instance, out front, I mentioned the two massive stone lions that her grandson spoke about. They gotta be somewhere. Where would something like that go? And just to locate the tapestries, as Carol, as you did, is, I think, an amazing piece of detective work.
We have more to go in Marilyn Rye's print.
So I think many mysteries remaining.
Walter?
What?
Do you have any?
Well, as I said when we met earlier today, one thing that really astounded me was the fact that when Mrs. Twombly died, she could not fulfill her pledges to Grace Church and the nuns. Taxes took everything she had along with her bequest to her family. So she did not, she had to renege on those bequests. And it was a significant kind of occurrence for a woman who had lived in absolutely unbridled luxury all her life. You know, you start talking about $10,000 a day, you have to multiply that, I would say, by a minimum of 6, but probably 10 to 12 to get the equivalent a day. They had unlimited funds, they really did. Their chef, as a matter of fact, I have a short story about. They asked him once what he cooked at home. And he said, I never cook at home, I have a chef. Mrs. Twombly's chef, they hired a chef for it. He also had a home up at Newport. And a private car on the railroad train that went up when she went up.
We'd like to open it up to any questions that you have for Walter or Arthur. Yes.
I heard at one time that we had an old faucet.
An old what?
Gold faucets.
I don't think so. That's the Trump era, not the Twombly era. Or Dennis Kozlowski. That kind of ostentatious consumption. Is, you know, much worse today than it was then.
The worst sterling silver doorknobs, I know.
Yeah, they were. They were.
And this is very interesting. This mansion is very different from the ones up in Newport built by Florence's brothers. One of her brothers, Cornelius, built the Breakers. And if you've been up there, you know what that's all about, a marble house. This is nothing like that. This is a very different sort of lavishness.
Some of them had gold.
Up there, yes.
Up there.
But you don't see the ornateness here that they were doing up there. I think that's the result of Hamilton's conservatism. You, in fact, Walter, called him cheap at one time. I said, that's sort of an interesting way to think of it. But certainly a guy who was financially very prudent. And maybe that's how they kept their money for so many years. He made these great investments. So even during the Depression, there was a great flow of cash coming in to support this operation.
In spite of Arthur's presence here, I'll tell you that many of the proper Bostonians, including many of the Twombly's, regarded Hamilton's marriage to Florence as an example of hypogamy, marrying down, because they had been, you know, at the upper crust of society in Boston for several generations.
Any other questions? Yes,
Ron. Whose child are you, and how do you say the lineage?
Okay, that's a good question. Very confusing, because my grandmother's name was Florence, and her middle initial was A, just like this Florence here, but not related. A distant member of the Vanderbilt family, it's a large family, and I think we descend from the Commodore's father's brother, some sort of distant little branch like that.
Assets and
I'll start there. This is the third generation here, the grandchildren of the Commodore, and they were not involved in the family business, which was the New York Central, and that maybe was one of the problems. They were all involved in building tremendous estates like this. Biltmore is one of Florence's. That was her younger brother, George. Of course, he ran out of money doing that. The breakers up in Newport and Marble House, those were not held in that condition for many years by that family because they were running out of money. This one kept going much longer than any of the others because of Hamilton's smart investments. He invested, for instance, in some sulfur mines down in Louisiana and Texas, which during the Depression days, long after he was gone, were producing an income for Florence and Ruth of $3.5 million a year during the Depression. When the sulfur ran out, they struck oil. So the money kept coming in to this family. I've often thought Ruth died in 1954, an early death. She was in her mid-60s, maybe. If she had lived as long as her mother, this estate here could have kept going into the 1960s, 1970s, maybe, with no trouble.
Maybe some of you wonder how it came to be Fairleigh Dickinson Center. The place was bought. In fact, I have a friend who is the wife of one of she's the daughter of the man who bought this property, Briscoe. And she was married to a man named Kelly, who formed an alliance with two Italian realtors, Italian-American realtors, and sold it off to the Twomblys over the objection of our then president, Dr. Sammartino, who, as I said once in one of these presentations, regarded getting Florham as putting an elephant in the back seat of your sedan. He didn't want it at all. He thought it was going to drain the university's coffers. Actually, has been a boom. But they got it from Exxon, which bought it from the Kelly Briscoe Group. And before the agreement was even signed, Dr. Sammartino had people in here painting, working, $25,000 for each of the classrooms, for instance, which was half the going price for new construction at the time, 1958. So they got a good deal. And I think they paid something like $1.5 million or so for the whole 100 acreage, not excluding the part on the other side of Park Avenue. But it was a good buy. It was a very good buy. Pushed by Edward T.T. Williams, who was at the time a leading officer of the Menin Corporation, and he used to come through these grounds every day on the train and saw it being open. So he said, let's get it. And we did.
They did, yes. It was kept here. As we come in through the gatehouse, right on the left, I think, is the area where it was kept. And that would haul things up to Newport and back to the city, that type of thing. Yes, yeah.
It's a virtually self-sufficient little community. I mean, they had stuff brought in by the track trains, you know, heavy durable goods. Yeah. They had their own sheep farm. They had their own greenhouses. The greenhouses, by the way, may be of some interest to some of you who are locals. They were designed by a Madison man. What was his name? There's a street name for him. Emma Joy, you know. Ruth Churchill's father. What was his name? Noe, N-O-E. He designed the first greenhouses with louvered glass so that you could get ventilation. And they were the ones that the Twombleys put up in the parking lot behind the library here. You can still see the lines of the greenhouse on the brick wall.
When were those taken down?
Pardon?
When were they taken down?
Before I came here.
Before, yeah, okay.
Before 58, yeah. I don't know.
Yeah. Another question back here?
Yeah.
I had a question. Where was the siding for the railroad originally, the private railroad siding?
I think as you come through the gatehouse entrance, right on the left, is there a playing field down there? I think it's in that area. And it's somehow connected up with the railroad. Interesting enough, in the stables, in addition to the horses, they had 15 Rolls Royces, maroon, all the same color, maroon Rolls Royces. And they would leave here to go to Newport. It was a procession of these cars with the helpers, the servants, and the family, and whatever they wanted to bring up, and then down to New York City. It must have been quite a sight.
John Mason Brown comments on the limousines. Mrs. Twombly took one every Sunday down to Grace Church, and it was violet. John Mason Brown said Mrs. Twombly was inviolate, A-T-E, and inviolate every Sunday. Her chauffeur staff changed their uniform sometimes three times a day.
About the trip to California.
About the what?
Oh, yes.
Oh, well, Arthur probably knows that better than I do. When she went out to the wedding?
For her grandson, Shirley. Shirley, of course, I know why they called, he doesn't know why they called him, his name Shirley was a man. He married the niece of Douglas Fairbanks.
Senior.
Senior, yes. And Florence was then, I think, in her 80s. And her doctor says, no, I will not allow you to fly out there. So she's wondering, how can I want to go to the wedding, how do I get out there? This was during the Depression days, in the middle of the 1930s. She says, well, take one of the Rolls Royces, but I don't want to be kidnapped. So what I'm going to do, I'm going to dress as a maid. I'll put my maid dressed as me in the back seat, and we'll be okay. Can you picture the poor maid taking the first hit on this? And they got out there. And one of Florence's comments out there was very interesting. She says, in my day, we had the celebrities. Today, if you please, the celebrities have us. Because there was a bunch of movie stars out there at that time. So life had changed in that period. But that's how she made it out to California.
What was on the parcel that is now Madison High School?
Ah.
What was the question?
What's on the parcel that's now the campus of Madison High School? Where is that located? Where is that?
Up here. It was given by the Twombly family to the borough, as you know. And what was there originally?
Yeah.
I think it was undeveloped ground.
Is it off in this
you
area?
Have a different idea, John?
There are no remnants of anything from that era there, so it could have been undeveloped, yes.
There's a very fine photograph down in the Madison High School, which I think sheds some light on your question. I'm not sure. But somebody's told me there's a very large photograph in the hallway in Madison High.
Most of that mural has decayed. I'm not sure what state it's in.
There's a tremendous amount of acreage here, as Walter, as you said. So that, I think, was one parcel over in that, back in that corner?
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's a long Ridgedale.
Right. Yeah.
It's now in...
Correct. Yes. Yes.
Did they have an elevator in the house at all?
There was no
elevator. No. They had a dumbwaiter. It's still, yes. I don't think it's there. At the very end of this hall, which is 100 and some feet long, by the way, on the very end, near that car glass window, on this side, there is an opening. That was a dumbwaiter. And I think the university, Mrs. Twombly used it because the stuff would come up from the kitchen that way to the breakfast room. But we had to get rid of it. It was being used promiscuously by the students in 1958. They were hauling each other up and down, you know, and it became a hazard. So did the bathtubs. The bathtubs were so long, so big, that some of the women who weren't, you know, basketball players could actually float on their back in the water. And one of them almost drowned one night, so we had to get rid of the bathtubs too.
And why don't you join us at the reception, and if you have any more questions, you can speak to Walter.
Thank you.
Thank you, Carol and Arthur and Walter. This is a...
Thank you.